Artistic activity and to facilitate critical reflection, both bilaterally, that is Germany, Korea, or multilaterally, with other European countries, or even between finally the project that we did with a fellow panelist, a contribution and possible organization to German-Korean project.
Good afternoon and welcome to the first auditorium panel of Transmediale 2016. This particular stream follows the MAKE stream, and as the chair of the stream, I'd just like to provide a little bit of context to the panel discussion that we're going to have. So one of the main statements for the MAKE stream is that maker culture has mainstreamed. And so what do I mean by that? Well, basically I mean that crafting your own beer, hacking into your computer, looking under the bonnet, knitting your own sweater, all of these types of making practices have actually become now quite popular, and therefore in that case they have actually mainstreamed. But the actual DIY ethos, which sits behind some of that values that sits behind that particular culture, such as doing it with others, looking at the production methods that actually inform actually how we make and the ethical implications of it, also then put the whole community into a kind of like juxtaposition, because at one point it stood against mainstream production processes. And in this way, that's actually what I meant by asking the question, where exactly are we now as makers and how do we reposition ourselves within that particular context? And this has actually quite a few actual questions that it raises in particular. For example, if government and policy are going to take these values, in a sense, that are assumed and deeply rooted into the community and transpose them into educational policies and startup economies, what does that actually then again mean for the original community and also the transposition of values from one culture to another? What happens then if we all do take on the ethos of making, 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 etc.? Does it actually mean that the ecological footprint of actually what we're doing makes sense if we're all going to be reproducing new products and turning out our own little mini factories in our kitchen? And what also does it mean for labor rights in these particular conditions as well? Will it replicate existing kind of norms of low wage, precarious work situations and so forth? So when we talk about repositioning maker culture, it was in this context that this panel was actually put together. And purposely three different positions were taken, inviting speakers who all could give an angle into that. And just so that you're aware, initially Annette Mulberg was going to join us to address those particular labor issues, but unfortunately due to illness she couldn't join, so Tuomo Tammenpää has kindly stepped in at the last minute and will give his perspective. He has a long history as a maker himself and also will be contributing to the discussion in relation to his own practice and the transition then into sort of startup economies. So without further ado, I'm going to briefly introduce each one of our speakers, including our moderator, and then hand over the proceedings. So first of all, speaking will be Jocelyn Bailey from the UK. Jocelyn is a designer who's worked at a senior level for various UK consultancies, design agencies and government. She's also working on her PhD at the moment with the focus on how design strategies are implemented within a government level. Following Jocelyn, then we have Tuomo Tammenpää, based in Kemio, small island of Finland, and has for the last 10 years been working across the broadly speaking, maker culture, as also a social entrepreneur, and has currently working on Loop, which is an audiovisual application, which you'll also speak a little bit more about later on. Following Tuomo then is Kate Rich. Kate is a feral trader and volunteer financial organizer for the Cube Microplex in Bristol, which is one of the only independent artist-run spaces and artist-owned venues within the UK. And Kate will be speaking from her perspective, again, also as a maker, having previously worked with BitBureau, and also looking at the transition then, the economic implications of maker culture from a grassroots level. All of this will be moderated by Juha Huuskonen, who is currently the director of HIAP in Helsinki, which is an art residency program. But Juha also comes from a programming and artistic background with a long interest in the democratization of technology, having also in 2012 run the Alternative Design Forum in Helsinki, and also coordinated the open source framework in Helsinki in the same year as well. So I think we have a very interesting mix of perspectives to open up the discussion of what we mean by repositioning maker culture. Hand over to Jocelyn.
Thank you very much, Teresa. So as Teresa mentioned, I'm a designer by background. I'm currently working for a design agency called Us Creates that focuses quite a lot on social challenges, problems that government's grappling with, particularly things around health and well-being. I'm just going to talk a little bit today about how I've seen creative practices, and particularly things around making and hacking and designing, transitioning into government, and talk a little bit about some of the questions that I think that raises. So this is the company I work for, Us Creates, which is a very awkward name that I have to spell out on the phone quite often. This is what we do: user insight, service design, and communication design. But actually, mainly what we do is sort of, most of the people that work there are designers, and mainly what we do is take that, I suppose, philosophy and way of seeing the world and approaching problems and apply it to all sorts of different things. But I suppose with a focus on trying to make the world a better place, predominantly through thinking about people's health and well-being. That's a picture of us doing a workshop. That's, I suppose, what it looks like a lot of the time, the sort of materiality of what we do. We are probably fueling the post-it note company's profits quite substantially. So that's the company I work for. But I also am sort of bringing to this a background in politics and in policy. So I worked for a think tank for a number of years, spent a lot of time in and around this building, which is the Palace of Westminster in London. And when I was working there, I was mainly thinking about how government policy affects the design industry and affects the creative industries, and writing a lot about that and lobbying for certain things. So we looked at education policy, we looked at intellectual property policy, we looked at procurement, so how government goes about buying the services of creative practitioners. And I suppose what that gave me is a bit of an overview and a perspective on the design industry and the creative industries and the sort of dynamics that affect how they work. And also a bit of an insight into government and how it works and doesn't work a lot of the time. So while I was there, I started writing and reflecting quite a lot on the things I was coming across in my work, and that has sort of transitioned eventually into a PhD, which, as Teresa said, is looking at how design's being mobilised in different ways in political contexts. So that's kind of the perspective that I'm coming from. What I wanted to talk a little bit about, just to give you a bit of a flavour, these are some of the briefs I'm working on at the moment. So working with the NHS on how do we increase the numbers of women taking up antenatal care services, working with the Department for Work and Pensions, which is a central government department, on how do we improve the quality of people's relationships. And that is, I mean, there's so many odd and interesting things about that project, but we don't really have time to go into it. And then working again with the NHS and a health sort of charity think tank, trying to think about how we could turn the NHS into a continually learning organisation so that the same mistakes don't happen repeatedly. So that's some of the stuff I'm working on. What I was going to talk about today, though, was this this phenomenon of sort of making, hacking, design-y culture transitioning into government culture. So these are just a few screen grabs I picked up yesterday. So here we've got things from the sort of government's own websites talking about using agile methodology to generate ideas for a policy project, talking about using the different phases of web development and service design, discovery, alpha, beta, live, which has become like a little mantra in the sort of digital bit of government. We've got something called UK GovCamp. I don't know what that is, but there's something about this sort of terminology of camps, hackathons, sprints, scrums, jams, like this are sort of popping up all over the place, and it's but sort of from the inside of the institution. quite recently, the thing with a sort of a concrete background on it. Quite recently, there was an NHS Transformathon. I don't really know what that was. But right down, there's two tiny for you to see, but right down at the bottom it says, if you want to find out more about hackathons, click here. So there's this kind of adoption of, and I haven't quite decided whether they're really doing it or whether it's an adoption of the terminology and because it's trendy or, I don't know. I think this sort of, the question about language itself is an interesting one, and I think we might come back to that in the discussion about about the sort of the power of language in this space and branding things in a certain way, which then creates a sort of captures a certain territory for a certain group and then stops other people from participating in it or identifying with it. But that's a slightly separate question. So anyway, all this stuff is happening and we've noticed it. And the reasons why it's happening are manifold, and it's probably got something to do with the digital transformation of government agenda. But there is a sense that some of the people involved in the digital transformation of government see the applicability of these processes, which are mainly to do with getting government on more services, transactions, things online, and making them digital, see the processes they're using for that as being applicable to other bits of government. So thinking, I guess, about more complex policy problems. So there's kind of two, I'm sort of in a position now, and also in relation to my PhD, where I don't quite know what I think about this. So I think there are some reasons why it's good. it sort of suggests that there's an increasing mindset of being adaptable and being flexible in approaches to solving problems, in being sort of agnostic about what tools you use. But the important thing is, does it help? Does it do the job? There's something about, I suppose, when you're dealing with incredibly complex problems, not feeling like you have to pull them all apart and separate all the different bits and critique them and analyze them and understand them, but that actually by making and doing something, that might be the way that you understand or you learn something about a complex system. So I think those things are positive, and the idea of sort of taking tools from any field and sort of hacking them and sort of suiting them to your needs, and especially in the policy environment, being a little bit more flexible about how you do that is probably, that could be seen as a good thing. I'm just going to skip through that slide. I'm also have some big questions about it. So there's a thing for me around whose agenda is being is being served in the adoption of this of these tools and methods and terminology? And is it masking something? So with that NHS transformathon, at the moment there's a bit of sort of legislation or policy change going through, which is about junior in the UK, which is about junior doctors' contracts, and it's basically the upshot of it will be that they have to work for longer for less money or something. Lots of junior doctors are very angry about it. And partly from a kind of patient safety perspective, they're very angry about it. And at the same time, there's this kind of, the onus for innovation is somehow being, with the sort of the hackathon mentality, the onus for innovation is sort of being pushed onto these public servants who are kind of in this increasingly squeezed space between what they're being asked to do, sort of statutorily, and the resources with which they're being given to do it. And the answer to that seems to be for them to hack the way that they do things. So I think that sort of there's something not quite right there to me. And there's also a thing about this sort of discovery, alpha, beta, live, like logical, linear process that is probably quite appropriate for developing websites. Like, we don't need to agonize forever about what the car tax website looks like. We could probably just get on and do that. But I think it's sort of the idea that you could apply that same process to other bits of government misrepresents actually the sort of the different nature of some of the problems that different bits of government is grappling with. So essentially what I'm trying to say is you can't efface democracy and politics with a nice kind of like user-centered design process. It might seem much more efficient, but actually democracy is inefficient for some very good reasons. So I have some questions about it. That's kind of what I'm in a slightly schizophrenic space where I'm doing this job as a sort of design practitioner in politics, but I'm also then worrying about these things. So these are some of the questions I've been thinking about recently. Whose agenda are we serving? So with the NHS project I'm working on, that's very much about getting women to do what the NHS wants rather than the NHS to respond to what women want or need. What values are embodied in that work? How self-conscious are we of the ways in which creative practice is being mobilised? So that might be sort of what we're doing with design, but also what we're sort of talking about today, which is more the kind of maker culture. And how complicit are we in that, and are we comfortable with that? And actually, Kate asked me earlier, so what's your answer to those questions? And I'm afraid I don't have one. At the moment, my position is just that I'm thinking about it still. Thank you.
Hello. Yes, indeed. My name is Tuomo Tammenpää. I'm a designer, entrepreneur, maker, I guess, and as Teras pointed, I was called in yesterday to replace or sit in for another panelist who couldn't make it. So this is probably the fastest presentation I've done ever. So if it looks like it's done just before I present it, that's because it has been. So apologies for typos and weird things there. That's me. Due to this kind of quick makeup of the presentation, also we talked a little bit yesterday on how we should do that, and I know Teres for years, and she knows my work, so it was best to kind of if I kind of travel through what I have been experienced the maker culture via my work and try to kind of point out a few of the eras or stages where the kind of this very broad thing that we kind of sometimes call maker culture has happened. So this will be my kind of a journey in four sections. So my kind of, for me, it started in 2002. So my hello world for this was kind of the discovery of microcontrollers. And I was doing kind of interactive art installation then, and I was kind of lacking the tools for extending the interface from the keyboard and mouse towards more kind of sensory environment. And my friend introduced me this fantastic piece of technology called basic stamp, and I was amazed that I can now kind of control things and read things and censor things from the computer, and that was kind of love from first sight. Also this breadboard and first bit of electronics. I didn't have any experience on that, so it was all kind of learning by doing. At that time, kind of scarce amount of information available, so it was everybody who was kind of doing that stuff without the engineering experience or education had to kind of guess a lot and smoke and pop lots of components while doing that. But it was great fun, and that kind of discovery with electronics led quickly something more fun even to kind of open up existing products and kind of avoid the warranties and be playful with them. So it was kind of in the context of circuit bending or make funny noises. I'm sure this is kind of quite familiar to this audience. But the kind of important bit there was to kind of demystify the technology, that kind of dare to open it, break it. I own it, so I can do whatever I like to, not to kind of the purposes. Maybe it was kind of made by the manufacturer, but I can kind of expand that. This kind of discoveries or kind of learning by doing led to kind of more of a belief on that actually we can do that stuff without any kind of previous education for that. And I found a partner, a good game programmer in England, and we started to kind of play with these things. And I managed to do actually a working product very quickly, just by kind of browsing stuff and learning, browsing online and making kind of random guesses how to kind of fit the components together, and managed to do this kind of playful game prototype that was kind of wireless interactive dominoes. So that was the proof for concept us that actually we can do that. That it's not making yourself your stuff can be quite rewarding, and you will get kind of good results on that. Then things start to get more sexy. I think 2005. There was a few things that happened kind of in the same time, or not same time, but in a very short period of time. There was a YouTube. The fantastic distribution channel for all these weird things people are doing. There was the Arduino, yet another microcontroller, RepRap 3D printer, the DIY one, and the Make magazine. And suddenly things were more kind of glossy and interesting, and interesting in the kind of business wise maybe for somebody. And so it was kind of first marks of this kind of maker culture. I guess around that time, I personally was bumped into the kind of the maker culture. Actually, it's something this DIY hacking thing was suddenly called as a culture. So it was kind of growing up, and being geek was suddenly kind of cool, which was probably unheard of before. We started to learn further and found out about manufacturing things, so you can actually send stuff to China and they will send something back, and you don't have to be a kind of a big company for that. You can be just an individual, and this was kind of a learning curve for understanding of that this is kind of a growing up, and there's even more possibilities. Been delighted about the community around the DIY culture, that always if you look for something, you usually find very quickly help. So this was kind of the peer learning process and learning with other people and running workshop together led to implicit need almost to pay back a little bit. So also share the knowledge and help the others who is in kind of their starting path. And that has been a quite fundamental thing about, I think, the culture ever since, that that this is very, it's very openly shared, and it's very kind of easy to kind of cross-pollinate in a between very, very different kind of people working on these various things. One fundamental part was Pixelate Festival. Juha was starting and running for a decade in Finland, so that was the kind of the forum, main forum in Finland for kind of coming together with these discoveries and in various different fields and especially concerning the maker culture, the digital craftsmanship was one term that was kind of proposed at one point, and that kind of resonated in a way that this old kind of tradition of craftsmanship, making kind of things with your hand and being good at it, this kind of in a way digital layer was added to it, and so it was kind of the latest in the long chain of kind of craftsmanship, in a way proposing also towards kind of more professional kind of take on that, so out from the hobbies towards something more kind of professional. The kind of third era for me was when open hardware was kind of the open hardware terms were kind of kind of popping up there. It was a lot of things was open in any way, and sharing was important. But this kind of to guarantee the sustainability of all these things, maybe the logic from the well kind of. Proven open source software, maybe that kind of logic could be adapted also to world of hardware and physical things. Obviously not so easily, but still that was the kind of ethos and still is, I hope. And we were kind of thinking in this kind of, I started in one conference in Banff in Canada in 2008, I think, or 2009. And there was kind of a group of people around the open hardware topic, and we kind of started to think if the open source software definition would apply for hardware and kind of guarantee those four freedoms, and to secure somehow that we were thinking of this kind of a key to put on or label the products. So from the key or the kind of identifier, you could find all the documentation and improve and repurpose the something that's already kind of been done, and campaigning kind of the open hardware to the maybe more larger public with the kind of re-campaign and point the values of open hardware. Browsing a bit further, then the things get kind of off the grid, things got online, making sensors that are wirelessly connecting, and started to kind of think about a little bit where's all the value in here. So it's not just for me learning something, maybe make environmental sensors, maybe kind of create products that are kind of are saving energy. This is kind of a more empathetic energy indicator. And things were kind of growing up yet kind of another stage. My kind of the last bit has been the couple of trips to China and getting even more serious about it in good and bad. So basically the kind of things like Raspberry Pis and these powerful computers and better technology enabled the use of those in kind of a physical space and make actually real things and installation, so that started to kind of also pay back. So all those skills learned were not just in kind of hobbies anymore. They were used in professional work, and I could run workshops and get a little bit paid out of it and kind of start to think how to, is this something that started for fun? It actually is turning to a kind of a profession in a way, and the kind of the proliferation of maker spaces and the kind of a massive boom in that sense and especially in China, in Asia, which is kind of a one trajectory. I'm running out of time, but that was kind of that's where I'm kind of personally at this moment. So for me, I think I am maker. I wouldn't love to be back kind of the return to the fun part of it. So the I'd like to be more think about this being amateur and kind of a lover of things where things were not so serious. So a little bit back to the fun part. Thank you, and sorry for the overtime.
Hi. So I'm an artist and trader, and I'm actually going to overpower Tuomo's history and go back to 1992, so 10 years earlier. But I won't. Don't worry. I'm not going to take you through every year. But this is where I started out, and this is actually in Melbourne, in Australia, where I'm from. This is a group, Bureau of Inverse Technology, that I worked with through the 90s as a media artist, and we really, that's on the Bureau of Meteorology in Melbourne, and I'm the one furthest away from the edge. And we were a group that came of age in the first media art, net art boom of the 90s. And we really sort of came of age on circuits such as this one. This is very familiar and you know, actually lovely habitat, the symposium and conference circuit, exhibition circuit, and there was certainly a lot of money sloshing around in the 90s for this kind of thing. So we came out of Melbourne and then, you know, sort of really became world creatures where we could travel around to situations like this, meet people, exchange ideas, and really sort of feel like we were part of milieu, develop really good networks of culture and, you know, sociality and ideas. However, I started to become troubled about this at the end of the 90s when I went to an event such as this one and a very nice curator slash friend asked me, so what's your new project? And I was getting the feeling of like, you know, why do I need to have a new project? Because I won't get invited to something if I'm still doing the same one. And really getting a sense of media artists, particularly as prototypers, reflecting the technology industry that was somehow kind of murkily supporting this whole scene. And I felt that there was this drive to prototyping, which is basically doing things roughly and shoddily with few resources, that the resources were arbitrary and instrumentalizing, that particularly when you saw the sort of field of sponsor logos around an event, there were obviously the technology companies, generally the airlines and the hotel industry that were supporting such environments. But the economy of this was opaque. So I could go on and on about that, but I won't, because I want to move into the turn of the century. My reaction was to retreat into the infrastructure, which is where I sensed the locus of power and influence was, with the need to actually look at, manage, and sort of infiltrate, I guess, the resources, the economy behind these things, the administration. And also, rather than to be what I sort of would have described as an artist in endless circulation around these kind of delightful but very temporary habitats, to dig in and hold a position. And in chess, it's, you know, kind of like castling, if you're familiar with chess. So I specifically decided to get involved with the supply lines. So I'm going to show three projects relating to that. And the first is feral trade. Feral trade is an import-export grocery business, all my suppliers and all my customers are either friends or friends of friends of friends of friends. And almost all of the freight follows existing journeys with the goods traveling in mine and other people's baggage. So here's a familiar habitat for the traveling artist. Has anyone ever been to one of these places? This is some luggage en route to Transmediale, some coffee heading for Hong Kong, some coffee crossing Berlin only yesterday, some hot chocolate in the arrivals lounge from Mexico, a very incurious Holiday Inn Express clerk handing over a plastic bag with my name on, which was blue corn that had traveled from Mexico via Poland to Epsom Racecourse outside London, where someone, a courier who I hadn't met, was attending the Dermatologica convention, such as this one. So the just one fantastic Swiss cheese arriving in Bristol Airport, and I actually made a sale in the airport arrivals area. And of course, there's the monetary transaction that comes the other way. And all of these transactions are reported in detail on my website. And this is the staff room of the Tate Modern. So what you get partly, in part, from this, so what I'm trying to do is harness the surplus hot air of the institutional media art circuit, basically. Here's some of my pet institutions. I too have been to the Banff Centre. Some great places. So here they are with their portraiture in grocery freight, rendered as grocery freight. Et cetera, et cetera. That's the whole network. Here's a familiar habitat. And a first delivery for the Museum of Modern Art in Warsaw. Is anyone going to Warsaw? Because I have three bags
of coffee.
Seriously, okay. All right, you're not Christoph, are you? Yeah, maybe we could talk about this afterwards because I'm on the clock a bit. Okay, great. So there's more in the suitcase. Actually, is anyone going to Brussels? Okay, can we talk afterwards? Thank you. To move to my second subject, which will be a little quicker, the Cube Microplex is the autonomous cinema and art space where I work at in Bristol, which is obviously handled. It's the platform on which I was able to build this business, and it's handled many shipments in its time. I was thinking, like, talking about an autonomous art space in Berlin is like, in English we say taking coals to Newcastle, but apparently you say Eulen nach Athen, which is a lot less obvious. To be brief about the Cube, all I would like to do is point out several maybe unique vectors about it. One is it's completely volunteer-run and does not receive state revenue for its normal business. The second is that we bought it. It's been running for 18 years ago, and 2 years ago we raised the money to buy it outright, take it off the real estate market, and put it in a community land trust for perpetuity. And that's my favorite part of the Cube. I'm administration and finance practitioner there, and I'm really trying to make that, reinstate that as a creative practice, creative accounting. And that's our server, which is in the corridor, which leads me to the third project I'm briefly showing, which is Cube Cola, yet another spin out from the Cube, which is closer to conventional maker culture. It's a open source cola drink, there it is in the flesh. It's the after coffee, it's the other black gold of the commodity world. So we make that there and distribute it. It tries to really evade product form, so this is its sort of most best instantiation as a syrup. And part of it is to render the open source ideology of the Cube in the bar supplies. And it's also, of course, an economic unit that travels around and gets sold. I'm going to just sneak in one more sort of fourth project very briefly that is something, just I'd like to flag this up, something that I've been involved in recently. And this is almost like the cube, but at sea. It's the Sailing Cargo Alliance, and I'm a founding member of, and it fits closely with feral trade, of a new European group that is moving products around the European area and also to and from the Caribbean with wind sail. And this brings together some of the reasoning behind the other projects, which is very much driven by looking to remake business forms, but really also from not at all from an efficiency basis, this is not an efficient way to do things, but from a spirit of adventure and a desire to live differently. So this is just some of the stuff I'd like to talk about at the end. So here's the one of the Sailing Cargo Alliance ships in port, and we are actually planning to do a cola cruise of the world by sail, where we travel the world, pick up ingredients, make cola at sea in some kind of sea commons, and trade it in the port. So it brings together all the threads. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tuomo, Jocelyn, Kate, and thank you, Teresa, for inviting me. So my name is Juha Huuskonen, and I'll be moderating the next about 1 hour. And before we get to the discussion, I wanted to contribute a couple of things to the context. So when Teresa invited me to moderate, and when I saw the topic, the what came to my mind was Transmediale 2001. And it was the first edition in this building, and the topic was do it yourself. And for me and quite many others, it was a very inspiring edition of this festival. And then the following year, 2002, we started Pix Lake Festival in Helsinki. And this idea of DIY was really instrumental and in main focus. And back then it was really related to internet. Like you would start your own radio station online, and there was indie media, etc. And then suddenly around 2004-5, there was this massive change. YouTube came about, and Facebook, etc. And that was a crisis, a kind of... And I guess it's like for this discussion, it's I think it's sort of interesting to think whether it's like crisis in a sort of in sense of like activist agenda or like a political project that a lot of people were at least thinking that they are part of some major movement to change the society, but suddenly they were just instrumentalized by corporate agenda. So this is one view to it. The other is more like a challenge for the community dynamics. Like this was something that was bringing people together, this similar, same mission, and suddenly it doesn't function any longer in that way. The other thing that I wanted to contribute is I brought a conversation piece, a coffee table book. It's a book by Hannah Arendt, The Human Condition, from 1958. I'm a big fan of Hannah Arendt, but I don't think this is her best book. But I think in this book, she tries to tackle sort of the same topic as we are trying to tackle today. So in this book, like she went to an area that she's not so familiar with, like to technology, automation, and so on. And I'll just read a little, I'll say something before I read the quote. So the main idea, which I think is great and very useful for the discussion, is to pay attention, like when we are talking about work and production and so on, is to be sort of more careful in what we are doing and how we are discussing it. So she's proposing, instead of just talking about work, is to use three words: action, being political, and being engaged in the polis, like discussing political issues, and then work, which is making, which is producing things, and then labor, which is us as human species. And she's also referring to Anthropocene and sort of similar topics. But I'll just read a little passage. So the title is The Traditional Substitution of Making for Acting. The modern age, in its early concern with tangible products and demonstrable profits, or its later obsession with smooth functioning and social ability, was not the first to denounce the idle uselessness of action and speech in particular, and of politics in general. Exasperation with the threefold frustration of action, the unpredictability of its outcome, the irreversibility of the process, and the anonymity of its authors is almost as old as recorded history. It has always been a great temptation for men of action, no less than for men of thought, to find a substitute for action in the hope that the realm of human affairs may escape the haphazardness and moral irresponsibility inherent in a plurality of agents. The remarkable monotony of the proposed solutions throughout our recorded history testifies to the elemental simplicity of the matter. Generally speaking, they always amount to seeking shelter from action's calamities in an activity where one man, isolated from all others, remains master of his doings from beginning to end. This attempt to replace acting with making is manifest in the whole body of argument against democracy, which the more consistently and better reasoned it is, will turn into an argument against the essentials of politics. So basically what she is saying and what she is annoyed about is that there's just too much focus on stuff and production and so on, and we are then kind of somehow being blinded and not seeing where the politics is and where that space of disagreement is and that we should have a way to act in that space. Okay, so these were my two contributions, but I would like to jump to the discussion, and I would like to start by sort of asking Tuomo to comment a little bit of what Jocelyn presented, and maybe I just to briefly give my own comment. I mean, I would feel that there's at least like two ways to approach this, like seeing people who enter the government process and that context as basically as craftsmen of participation. Like people who bring in this sort of expertise and approach that is sort of hopefully more rich and better. So basically, like the positive way would be to see that it's sort of democracy becomes better. So on the other hand, one could claim that this is very superficial, that it's not addressing the real issues, and then what we should be asking for is a sort of much more fundamental change and transition, and again the same kind of approaches and methods could be used in that level as well. And I guess the key issue is like on what level we are operating and so on. But I will, yeah. Tuomo, do you have any thoughts?
Well, yes. Well, let's see. Read the notes. So basically, I think the two thing I kind of rounded on my bullets was with this passing or using this kind of maybe methods for rapid prototyping and hacking things together, the ones who are being proposed with these new tools and methods, they are kind of forced in the situation that can be a little bit too much in the midst of whatever other responsibilities to start with. So this is kind of adding just extra work and maybe indifferently than when if in let's say the in DIY culture, when you gradually learn these things together in a group in over a long period of time, you kind of learn very your way of doing it with your usually your friends and peers. So that's kind of it didn't just happen like dropping it on your kind of table. So that's I can totally understand that. I would be very puzzled of if I would somebody would kind of introduce some method that is not known to me and said, okay, start using it. You know, hack it together. If it doesn't work, that's a bit unfair to kind of throw in you if you don't properly time for that. The other one was the kind of relating that was the alpha beta live thing, and that I can really kind of add up to that. It's been, I think, in the time when there was you know the book went to the printer or the record were pressed, you know, then the thing is done and it should be really good by that time. And now when all things can be constantly updated, we are kind of all the products and things are released mostly way too premature, just because you have to announce it now it's launched, and it's full of bugs. It doesn't work. It's not being tested, and in kind of rushed together, and that can be very. If it's a game software, it doesn't really matter. Then it's you know the users leave. But if you start to apply it for them something that it's kind of a fundamental part of I don't know democracy or learning process, that can be very very kind of dangerous. So. Those remarks on
any immediate comment?
Yes. Well, I agree. Yeah, I agree. thinking about is this on? Can you hear me? Yeah. Thinking about your question, Juha, about sort of being craftsman of participation and to what extent you. By bringing greater participation into government processes, you're enabling a different kind of, is it more democratic in a way? And I think it very much depends on the spirit in which it's done. So if there is a particular policy agenda and actually what the participation is being used for is to find out the most efficient way of making that particular policy work or stick, then I think that's not so democratic. but if it's something about actually trying to find out something that might then inform what the policy is or it turns out to be, then that's probably a bit better. But at the moment, I think there's an interesting thing happening in the difference between England and Scotland and how design in particular but also kind of like the digital transformation agenda is being mobilized in both places. And there's a real I feel that in Westminster it's a lot more about efficiency, and in Scotland it's a lot more about devolution of power and handing over power to to people. So I think it, as with any tool, you can use it well or you can misuse it, I suppose. One thing I was just thinking when Tuomo, you were talking, it was just about this labelling of something. So people tinkering with things other people have invented is a very human thing to do, and this idea of hiving off a particular community of people because they do that, in a way, that's almost seems to be stranger than this thing that we're seeing at the moment where, you know, in London, everyone's knitting on the tube. Like, why is that odd? I mean, haven't we always been doing that? And it isn't the weirder thing that for a while it was just a few people who were allowed to do it because they were called makers. I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, I can say that at least in Finland, this topic of how this idea of innovation and sort of resources, how it's used in politics is really crucial. Like at the moment, the current government, they have announced massive cuts, and then our prime minister, other politicians are sort of explaining that this is now a chance for you to innovate, and I think it's very much in the line of
thanks very much of
thinking that now you do like whatever hackathon and then you have a better solution for this. So, but we could return to this in a moment. Like to open up the discussion a little bit, I would like to ask maybe Jocelyn to respond to what Tuomo presented, and I'll just read a little little bit from a post by Cindy Kohtala. Last week, when I was preparing for this, I posted something on Facebook and got a lot of comments. And Cindy is just about to put out a PhD about maker culture. So she wrote that the maker subcultures that we should be supporting, like instead of going with the dominant narratives of the market, they should be in line with the local social needs, distribution of production and technology, making for the sake of learning, creativity, and joy. And ideally, they should also be aware of the things outside the makerspace, supply chains, energy consumption, unfair working conditions, raw material sources, and all those things that are otherwise invisible. So I guess what I wanted to ask, like, because you are a designer as well, like when you see like Tuomo's practice and this maker culture, like how you'd see like what are the valuable things there, and then as designers, like how can people maybe operate in this context?
I suppose, how do I feel about that? So I, even though I sort of have, there's big question marks for me over some of the projects that, well, not big question marks, but the projects that we work on raise questions about politics and participation and how different, how sort of participation is mobilized in different ways. But I still think that most people have a fundamental sort of urge to make things and create things and leave the world a slightly better place than they found it. And I think there's something, I mean, it's different in different countries, but there's definitely something about the way the education system works in England that's about somehow sort of suppressing that and encouraging people to think in particular ways and develop particular patterns of thinking, and then there does become a little subculture of people that think slightly differently, and have probably gone to art school, and don't necessarily think that they have to work by having meetings where words get written on bits of paper and passed around, but there are other ways of doing work and of sort of being in the world and of trying to change things. And so I suppose there's a little bit of me and probably and all the people I work with. This is a kind of like a public, service mentality. And actually, for lots of people who are working in government, have a public service mentality. They're not there, goodness knows, they're not there to make money most of the time. So I think while there is a sort of there is a need to be aware of what the bigger currents are. That you're sort of you're being sort of wafted around by. I think for lots of people that I work with, there is this A, desire to sort of do something good, and B, sort of be creative about that, or be more creative about that.
Okay, thank you. So before I open the questions to the audience, I wanted to ask from Kate. Because I mean, basically, you are more like a solo practitioner. So I was just curious to ask, like in comparison with what was just presented and discussed, like the make culture. It's I mean, what Tuomo pointed out, this sort of gradual learning that you are part of a community, you contribute to that community. I mean, that's something really essential, and then that's something you cannot just suddenly hijack. So I kind of wanted to ask, like in your own practice, Kate, like do you, what would be your peer community? Do you have such, or in a more sort of larger sense, like what is the, how do you see the sort of like what is the community that you are, or the network that you are working with? Like how is it composed and so on?
Sure. Well, I'm shocked that you think of me as a solo practitioner, so that doesn't happen often.
So the four projects that I presented are actually five, even the Bureau of Inverse Technology, all experimental forms of doing things together that may not have a very rigid container to them. So the Bureau was actually a two-person partnership. Feral Trade, while I'm the sole trader and coordinate the shipments, relies on a very loosely drifting network of several hundred people who come and go and who embody and transact the network. So that is a very sort of strategically a business without a business form. So it's not incorporated, it's not, it has no uniforms, vans, employees, you know, it's sort of like, how do you do DHL through, you know, these random encounters with people in the crowd or their friends or someone's mum or, so, but it doesn't, it's almost my self-portrait as a network. The Cube is a 150 or so, and, you know, due to the nature of the organization, we actually don't know and have no way of knowing how many volunteers we have. Because people are formally inducted when they join, and then they participate as they want to, so we don't really know whether people are volunteering or not. But we guess it's around 150 people. Every now and then we clean out the, you know, we take everyone off the mailing list and everyone has to go back on, and we always end up at 150 or so. And that is a long 18-year experiment in self-governance and working out how to do that, and that's a very, really quite diverse group of people, from artists to office temps, teachers, and, you know, people who do their 9-to-5 jobs and then come to the Cube to work the bar in the evening. And the Sailing Cargo Alliance is a coalition of traders and ships, which has decided to work together on a venture. And we've had several meetings in which we decided to not have a logo, for example, and to not have a letterhead and to not add a layer of branding to the group. But it's a shared endeavor.
No, maybe the comment, I mean, I guess the way I saw, I guess the one key and interesting question is like the Feral Trade project. Like, if you would stop, would it still continue? And then this is like in comparison to like maker and open source, etc. communities. I think it's super interesting that there is often someone called the benevolent dictator, like Linus Torvalds being the benevolent dictator of Linux community. And it's kind of, it's open, anyone can participate, but somehow still in the social dynamic, there is often this someone who is the trusted person who is keeping the community intact. So this is like the longevity and the durability of these projects. How do you feel about that? Like do they have to go on until forever, or would you be happy to wrap up Feral Trade when it feels right, and then go on to something else?
So I can give you two really quite different examples. So Feral Trade is a self-portrait. It's actually it actually is my life. It's continuous with my life. There's no point where I'm working or not working, and so it's unceasable till I cease. And I mean, I started it as a 20-year project, but then realized it was a 50-year project. It's completely dependent on me as the biological entity of whom the autobiography is. The Cube Cinema is the exact opposite, in that people always are looking for the, you know, people like, where's the dominant animal that, you know, if you remove that, the cube will fall apart. And it's a rare example of an organization that has managed to go through many generations of workers and ideas, and while some of the founders are still there, their influence is partial. Anyone could leave, and the Cube's developed an identity where really any 150 people could run it, through having developed a shared culture over time. You couldn't pass it instantly over to another 150 people, but it
has taken people in to the point that what we have together as a culture is much stronger than what any individual knows. But both of them are very deliberately not modeled on sort of GitHub or open source software development communities, where the model is designed for export, the idea that it's a template and you could do it anywhere. And I'm firmly convinced of both the fact that projects are local, which is Feral Trade's a kind of, you know, hyperbolic example of that on one person. But people always ask us, you know, how could you do the model of the cube somewhere else? And it's like, it's not a model. It's like, it's meaningless. It can't be outside of itself. It's an interesting example of what can be done in that place and time. So what I'm strongly advocating for is we need a biodiversity of these models, and that would communicate, you know, a lot of different animals and entities that can communicate with each other, learn from each other, trade with each other, but ultimately not anything designed to scale, I'm very suspicious of. The idea that you would, you know, oh, we could do these everywhere. And I'll just have a very short anecdote, which was I got a ride with some coffee recently with this guy who, friend of friend, who is the head engineer for the company that makes Otis lifts and all the surveillance cameras in England and all the fire sprinkler equipment in the world. So he's a very high-powered engineer. And he said, so what do you do? And I was like, oh God, here we go. And so I told him about Feral Trade, and he, you know, understood. And he said, I can see the social benefits, but what are the societal benefits? I was like, I don't know. I haven't really thought about that, you know, that question. And he was saying that, you know, when you put your coffee, so it goes on someone's bag on a plane, but it's still adding weight to the plane, and you're not making a carbon saving. And I just thought, like, wow, that's a really different way to look at it. I'm not doing something that is based on quantifying and accounting, and that you would multiply it to get a result. So I'm doing something that is looking at how you would change the narrative of something that exists already, that type of engineering, when you're just engineering the narrative, and through that shift an understanding of what efficiency is, what the values are, what the good is in goods. So it's a very incompatible way of thinking with a community that can scale.
Okay, thanks. So I think we could open up to questions from the floor. There's one microphone over there, and there's another one over there. So would there be anybody with any questions or comments? Anybody? I cannot see properly. Okay, so if there's somebody there, then you could, yeah, if you could please, because this is streamed, so if you could walk over to the microphone. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, so my name is Casper. I'm a PhD student working with children in education and making and design and hacking and all these different terms that you also have been using, right? So I was just wondering if you couldn't try to elaborate or define these different terms or try to differentiate them. So you talked about making together, which seemed to me as being different from hacking together. You also talked about hacking as putting things together, whereas that seems a bit different to making. And I also was wondering, like, can you put it on different levels? So for example, is, I don't know, design above making, or how could you talk about it? Because am I a maker if I make a fire, for example? Or like, am I a mathematician because I, you know, count my coins or something like that? So how do you differentiate between these different terms?
Tuomo, do you want to comment? Or?
Yeah, definitely you are a maker if you make fire or love or whatnot. I think there's the hacker term, and please, you know, correct me if I talk weird things. That's kind of obviously there's kind of the computer hacking history, and that's in very, I guess, from the level when you are really skillful of something on certain technology, you are able to misuse it. You have to first learn to use it, and then you gradually learn how to misuse it and kind of take it apart. So in a way, you can take things apart and break them, and then breaking them, and you can take things apart and kind of in order to kind of rebuild with them. So I would say that kind of the hacking way of at least originally has been quite kind of higher level of things. Making, as we all know, that's the oldest thing in, or I don't know, second oldest thing in the world. So it's a, so there's nothing. It's a bit. It just kind of, you know, it was good word for that, and it's a very, you know, clever branding from the O'Reilly, and you know, they kind of nailed it at times. So it, I don't know how interesting that as such go. That what is it? Is it a good word for that? But one thing came into mind when we stopped kind of making, so maybe that kind of helps, or stop making for a while at least. I think it was somehow synchronized with the kind of a consumerism, or when kind of the factory made replaced the homemade back in the day, maybe 50s. I don't know when kind of exactly that started to happen, but since then, before that, everything was obviously homemade. And suddenly this kind of factory-made or branded was introduced to us as a kind of superior or better, obviously, because they just kind of want to sell them. It was nothing strange about that. So basically it's very short time of if you take a human history of non-making things, and that's kind of maybe important to remember. And now when the maker movement of making is at least some extent maybe kind of taken over by the corporate logic just to make more money, the kind of making that as well is that kind of the end of, if it, you know, how to kind of return back to the or kind of pressure the kind of original way of kind of being curious and learn by doing. But yeah, I don't know, for the working with children is kind of extremely important that there's the kind of the curiosity and learning happen there. So it's is how important are those terminal terms as such to be used. But as for hacking has been kind of the higher level, and I hope everybody of us are kind of makers in that sense, that we take the kind of responsibility of understanding things and being curious about things and learning by doing stuff.
I would shortly like to comment as well this hacking making. I mean, this terminology question, we could always debate that and so on, but what I at least find useful is there's this one term called critical making. If you Google that, you will find quite a lot of articles, and the point is to, in the same way as there's critical thinking, you would have critical making. So kind of associating this as when you make stuff is a way to reflect on what you are doing and what is going on in the world and so on. So I find that very useful. And then I guess, like for me personally, this question of education and learning is super essential in this. And then this year they will start in Finland. They will start to teach coding in elementary school. It'll be like obligatory for all the students to learn coding. And so far, it doesn't look that it will be going well. The books that are coming out are like bad mathematics books. So there will be, I mean, a lot of young kids learning mathematics in an odd way and not having any sense of why this is interesting and so on. So I mean, some people in Finland are now trying to be active and try to change the agenda. It's more about I learned to do software the way Tuomo learned to do hardware and so on. It's really more about being playful and sort of coming across surprises and so on, rather than following this some ready-made agenda. So, okay, so I'll stop here, but would there be any further further questions or comments?
Yeah. I have a question. My name is Gottfried, hi. Thanks for the presentations. I don't really know if this is so much a question, but I just, tried to combine like two insights that I had while listening to you. I was really interested in the beginning of Kate of your talk, sort of like where you sort of like said that, or like where you mentioned how hard it is to sort of like have a sustainable artistic practice in the context of sort of like media art festivals and the sort of media art circus. And sort of the second thing that sort of like came to me was like, especially thinking about electronics, that when you do those things, you kind of learn that, actually sort of like, when you have a breadboard and you learn how to play with these things, you kind of really, like really soon realize like how old this thing is, like, and how old even the ideas and the textbooks and the theory and everything is. So I'm thinking like with regards to the sort of like the maker movement, or like the invention of the maker, and then the also again the disappearance of the maker. What if there always was the maker, and sort of like, because the underlying sort of like technical things have little changed, and sort of like what, maybe it's sort of like more a question of like, how can we create those structures that would afford these kinds of sort of like maker or like a hands-on do-it-yourself type of work.
That is a question. What was I going to say? Yes. So, regarding to making the livelihood, and I do have I could go on and on about that. There's certainly what I'm doing with feral trade. There's nothing new about it. It's really, people putting stuff in their bags and carrying it around for other people. It's just completely, actually, conventional. And what I'm doing it is articulating it in a slightly different context. And also, interestingly, and one of the reasons maybe why it's a sort of a sole trader project is, unlike hacking circuits, there is no community of people helping or sort of great development place to do it in. If you try and trade a commodity on your own, you're just completely kind of like, it's extremely different. And also making cola. As a two-person factory, that's a two-person collaboration, and the smallest, you've got to buy one of your ingredients, the smallest sample size is 25 kilos, because if you're dismantling the factory, there's no structure for that. So I've always found it really frustrating that outside of the electronics and coding world, where there's all this wonderful support, that for doing infrastructure and for doing all the other things that are natural to us to make, that were in a, I feel that have been removed from our hands actually quite recently as a form of enclosure. And I would say trade is one of the earliest enclosures, one of the first easiest things to enclose in a gilded profession. I'm losing my thread. Frustratingly, the community and the infrastructure for it isn't there, or isn't visible, or isn't tried enough. So one of the things I'm really trying to do with almost over-articulating the trade project is to bring that back into visibility and to kind of... My structures are transparent. Every transaction I do and how I do it is reported on the... documented on the product, so to sort of leave a trail of that. But I'm very frustrated of the removal of livelihood, to the fact that I still get paid more to talk about it than to manage to do it. But I'm impatient for to help an economy of form around that.
Okay. So there would be room for one more question. Is there one more? Yep, good.
Okay, so I guess one of the reasons I came to this panel is I wanted to hear a little bit more about your thoughts about what is the longer term impact on this mainstreaming of maker culture, on society, on design, on production, politics, economy, and as my friend said also, and is it important?
Right. what is the longer term? I mean, I suppose there is a thing about empowerment. Just to what you were saying about the sort of like the slightly longer history of, well, in fact, it's come up a couple of times now, hasn't it? This slightly longer history of making and what's happened in more recent history, which is a kind of disempowerment or a form of, you know, enclosure of lots of different things that would have been quite normal practices. So I think anything that draws people's attention to the fact that they have these capacities is good. I think we just have to be careful about how other interests might be mobilizing that. And that's where the point of language comes in, because people think things get labeled in certain ways that, and can then be used in certain ways. So I'm quite positive about it as a sort of, on, I guess, from the perspective of human flourishing, but I would just be wary about how different interests might take advantage of it.
I mean, there would be like a longer discussion that we could have on the what is sort of mutual or connecting all the presentations is this sort of this infrastructure level, like this economic level, like how to influence the governments, how to influence the trade, and then in the maker context, now that it's sort of really mainstream, like whether it's all manufactured in China and not economically sort of sustainable, or whether it's something that is actually a good sound practice. I mean, these are important questions, and there are like good relevant examples, like good sort of promising examples, like Estonia would be one. Like when you sort of boot up a country from scratch, I mean, they run the country with this X-Road software, which runs on Linux, and it can run on a Linux. You can install a Linux and run X-Road software, and then suddenly the whole country runs so much more smoothly, like you can vote electronically, and then you can get your recipes. And so on. There's a lot of privacy questions there. And this is interesting because it's like in that case, the Estonian people are using the system. They trust the system and so on. And now, and we can all register to be Estonians virtually. I mean, it's really remarkable. I mean, this is what they have done. And another example would be like with Obamacare, like they launched the site, which was not functioning. And then suddenly they parachuted like this group of 10 people who fixed the site, and then that saved Mr. Obama and the plan that everyone can have a health insurance. So, and this was clearly done in this with this hacking, making DIY attitude, but then they kind of had to go by they had to break the law in a way, because normally you have these procurement rules and so on. So I mean, I think there are sort of good examples where you can actually go like really deep in the structures and make something that is really good and better than anything that existed before. But in most countries, it's kind of the opposite. Like things kind of are quite the same as they used to be, and it's more like lip service to these ideas. Okay, so I think unless there's any last comments from panelists, I would give the mic to Teresa, so she could give her own comment and then tell a little bit of what's next. Any final words? No? Okay, next time. Okay, so Teresa.
Are you sure you don't have anything?
Maybe the just comment on the kind of the longevity or of I wouldn't be personally worried at all about maker culture as a category. Whatever happens, so that's not important. What I would kind of value from that is that the kind of the ethos where the things were born when people were kind of peer learning together. And all the kind of the grassroots logic and the kind of reorganizing yourself around different workshops, you have to constantly kind of be very aware of all the other people. So there wasn't nobody kind of was kind of leading the thing, but it was managed together. And this kind of passing on this kind of a knowledge, if you can guarantee that this kind of way of doing from kind of bottom up would survive somehow, so why that would be the valuable thing to sustain, and indeed how that is sustained is I think I don't know anything else but kind of keep doing it with the more with new people, with the kids and you know the grown-ups and elderly people, so just kind of keep doing it how it was kind of started in a way, and regardless how the thing is called or how the magazine is branded.
Thank you to the panel. I think it's the opening session, and at least there has been various threads there that you have tapped upon, which also in the spirit of the conversation piece, I'm just going to make some links to other things that are happening today and also in the kind of future sessions. So there has been a bit of a conversation there about what's a maker and what's a hacker. And I think it's important, as Jocelyn said, language and how things get labeled. It's difficult when you get to be asked to chair the stream make. And of course, you have to start to address what does that actually mean? What does maker culture mean? And that also then brings you up and bumps up to what does hacker culture mean? As we have said, maker is make culture has been branded, and it's now a corporate brand in a sense that demands us as practitioners within a space where we go in and do things for ourselves, to take upon that label upon ourselves and therefore position ourselves and figure out how we want to actually respond to it. Do we want to use it? Do we not want to use it? Is it useful or not? And as has been mentioned, since we've been walking on this earth and banging two stones together and lighting fires, we're makers. We're always going to be makers, and we're always going to be hackers as well. A hacker in particular, in comparison to a maker, is someone that looks at a system and tries to exploit that weakness. And in exploiting that weakness, you can have a variety of type of hackers then, such as black hat hackers, grey hat hackers, white hat hackers, who are going to do that exploit for their own purpose, and therefore in a sense perhaps cause damage or danger in an explicit way, or they're going to work for common good. And that's probably just in terms of the questions there, that to help clear up maybe some of these definitions between maker or hacker. Moving away though from those questions of language and not trying to exactly get bogged down to it, there was something I thought that was quite strong that came out both with Tuomo and Kate's work, which is basically to be a maker is to be an amateur, to do it for the joy, to do it for the pleasure. And in particular, what Kate said also, the spirit of living differently. And I think this is exactly the kind of core hub here of what we're actually kind of trying to address. The spirit to live differently, to change the narrative and to engineer the narrative, is actually at the heart of what we here are really discussing. And that spirit to live differently, perhaps we could say in this age of anxiety, in this controlled society that we're finding ourselves in, and that links to the wider themes of the festival, is a very difficult thing to do because of the lockdown that's kind of been imposed upon us. And I think that the work that Kate is doing is exemplary in that it's trying to find ways out, not even out of that narrative, but just to find alternatives that can empower us. And that essentially is what is kind of going to be sort of followed up in some of the other conversation threads that are actually happening in the coming, particularly in today. So if you're interested in some of that, I'd encourage you to go and listen to also Disinnovation Lab by Nicholas Margot and his colleagues. Also following immediately after this in the auditorium is the keynote for MAKE, where there will be historical kind of perspective as well put on this and further conversation along those lines. I think that also the, just I guess to end, which I don't know if there is a better ending than to say the spirit to live differently, which I think is the challenge here. But Hannah Arendt was a beautiful example of that. And I think that you poignantly raised there a quote from her, which was something that was actually in the spirit of this particular panel as well, which was to just examine the production values and the norms that get inherited and embedded when we have terms like hacker and maker culture being appropriated on a mass scale, and what are those kind of complexities really. And Jocelyn's work, I think, is trying to actually point at that, even if it's at a very early stage, to jostle with it on the governmental level. And I think that one thing is that there hasn't been here present on the panel a speaker from Germany, which we had been missing, of course, from Annette's perspective, but the UK would be probably one of the leading countries in terms of creative industries and ensuring that that monopoly gets rolled out in a way. And I think the fact that the governmental turns that are happening there is something that isn't necessarily happening at the same level on mainland continent of Europe. And different, of course, perspectives coming in from Finland as well, which I think is also the Scandinavian model is kind of different to Central European model as well. So I think that that's just something I should also sort of point out here, that in some way the missing voice of a German speaker from Central Europe will also be picked up in the following keynote. But also just to point out that I think that the panel with bringing a UK-Finnish perspective have actually brought at least those parts of the European perspective there onto the table. And that's also something that we should actually keep in mind as we go forward with the conversation. That's it. Thank you very much, and hope to see you in the keynote.